on the U.S. side, what's interesting is we had leaders elected who were had very different views on most on many political issues. Mm-hmm. Different political parties, different dynamics of the politics, but every leader ended up supporting an expansion of the relationship. Several of us made a trip to the Chinese embassy in Washington late at night, several days after this incident occurred. And we made the trip because we had gotten a call from the U.S. ambassador in Beijing on the secure line saying that that not only was our embassy under siege, but that it was inadequately protected by the Chinese side, and that the staff in the embassy had already undertaken all the emergency measures if you are afraid your embassy will actually be invaded. And so papers were burned, people were brought into the most secure part of the embassy, the Marine guards were pulled in but were armed. So several of us, Secretary Albright, a group of four or five of us, got in touch with Li Jiaxing, at the your ambassador to the U.S., went over to the Chinese embassy. The main thing that we wanted to do was to communicate that there was a very dangerous situation and on the brink of something that no one could walk back in Beijing. We didn't get a chance to say that. The Chinese side was so angry and so upset that they monopolized the conversation for quite a while. I finally signaled to the DCM, who was in the room, the Chinese DCM, who I got to know well and trusted quite a bit. We needed to step outside the room. We stepped outside and I said to him, look, regardless of what's going on in the room with the ambassador, I have to tell you that you need to get in touch with the very highest level in Beijing immediately. I explained why. And I said, if you wait more than an hour to get reinforcements around the embassy to protect it, I'm afraid we will have American Marines shooting Chinese demonstrators inside the U.S. embassy. And you can just imagine what that would do. And he said, oh. I walked back in, and he walked somewhere else, and he came back about 15 minutes later. As he walked in, he sat down and looked like that. That was all. And sure enough, the guards got deployed around there. That is the kind of thing where if you have had conversations with people, you got to know them, you can make that kind of connection, and sometimes it can be very important. I sat in on a number of meetings. Most of the time I wasn't in office, but I often knew the people who were directly involved with China in office. And I never heard one of them ever say, we're doing this because we expect that China by 2020 will be just like the U.S., multi-party democracy, et cetera, et cetera. I think that is a tremendous distortion of what we sought to achieve by our policy of engagement.
Right.
We did it in our national interest. We did it always being keenly aware that we have extremely different political systems. We have extremely different economic systems. We have different modern experiences with the international arena. That this is not a country that's going to be just like us. China, which inevitably would play a larger role in the future, will do so on the basis of a more modern economy, a better understanding of the rest of the world. But it will make its own choices. And its own choices will be as it sees its own national interests. So I think that this was all along a very serious effort with different specifics as our relationship evolved and, you know, things happened. Right now, I think we're in for a very tough period, to be honest. I think that that what we should be aiming for now is to prevent irreparable deterioration. I think the problems are on both sides here. I don't think they're all simply President Trump style and the consequences of that.
Right.
But the fundamental notion that we and the Chinese will do better if we have better mutual understanding, if we have more ties that bind us together,
right.
If we can keep it, what will inevitably be a difficult relationship, moving basically in a good direction.